This is a HeadGum Podcast.
Good morning, South Bend.
It's a bright, beautiful, sunny day in beautiful Indiana. The sun's rising over the reclaimed beer hall.
Our Badgers are sure to give it their all this Friday night. And I think Mayor Pete Buttigieg is going to give an appearance.
He might even take a swig of some of our homegrown ale from the Fiddler's Hearth Brewery. Mmm, love that IPA.
$4 pints and 2-for-1 Wing Wednesdays. Come over and hearth with us.
Book your two-night stay now at the Down on South on South 7. New bed and breakfast, excuse me. I didn't have my caribou coffee this morning.
Now, let's get back to the hits. 80s, 90s, and today.
Who's that knocking at the door? It's all your friends, you filthy whore. Your husband's gone, and we've got books and a bottle of wine to kill.
It's Hollywood.
It's books.
It's gossip.
I'm shook.
It's memoirs.
It's martinis.
It's Studio 54.
It's Celebrity Book Club. Come read it while it's hot. Celebrity Book Club. Tell your secrets, we won't talk. Celebrity Book Club. No boys are allowed. Celebrity Book Club. Club.
Buzz me in, I brought the Cuervo.
Hey, best friend.
Hey, best friend.
What literally is up?
Oh my God, this week has been crazy. So much coup.
A lot of coup. But first,
the real coup, which is the book that we read and we're about to talk about. I think it's, like, really important to provide context about current events by not just looking at the main players, but who's the woman, or in some cases,
the man
behind the man.
The book we read, it breaks stereotypes. Mm. It
shatters norms, you might say.
Mm-hmm. I would say shatters norms in what can even be conceived as a book because it basically reads as a family newsletter.
Truly is one of the least necessary books to have ever been written. Of course, we were talking about the memoir of Chasten Buttigieg.
So it's Chasten. It is Chasten.
And he does explain this at one part of the book.
And I know he did explain in the book, but I just couldn't wrap my tiny mouth around
it is a made-up word. Because chasten is, of course, this, like, Shakespearean word, which means, like, you know, to make something more chaste.
And he is kind of, he is very chaste.
Oh, he's pretty chaste.
Yeah.
But of course, Chasten Buttigieg is the husband to Pete Buttigieg, the failed 2020 presidential candidate.
The failed 2016 DNC chair.
Yes! Go off, bitch. Know your
DNC
politics.
DNC chair.
And you know, what's kind of ironic, or think about it, is that in 2016, Pete Buttigieg was sort of this, like, dark horse candidate who didn't really win. But ultimately, there was, like, a very tight race for the actual chair between Tom Perez and Keith Ellison, and the sort of establishment swooped in.
Hey, Mr. Politico, I'm just going to stop you there for one second, okay, before we get into this DNC nonsense, just to let our readers know, we are reading, and again, it's Chasten Buttigieg's book called I Have Something to Tell You.
Which, ironically, he doesn't really.
He doesn't have, it's like, on the one hand, he does have something to tell us, and it's every single goddamn moment of his life, because he has something to tell us because he has nothing to tell us.
Let me get into the cover for a second. I've never seen
something so D-list.
It's
it's actually C-list.
It's defining C-list. So it's a pale, he's wearing, like, a pale blue polo and a dark blue Banana Republic sweater over the pale blue button-down.
Warby
glasses. He's got this sharp little toothy smile. This sort of classic sharp little gay teeth.
The teeth also really, like, go back fast. You know what I mean? It's kind of bugs up front.
Well, can I explain this?
Gay mouth?
It's gay mouth, but a lot of gays have receding gums because they brush too hard.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. It's a self-conscious thing. That's related to gays having acne scars because they pick at their faces.
Right. And I would say his hair is...
classic gay hairline really, receding.
Yeah, it's receding a little bit.
It's a 4-head, it's a 5-head, honey, it's a 6-head. I mean, that's what I look like if I had this haircut. And he's just smiling the dorkiest little smile.
Big theater group smile.
It's I Have Something to Tell You is written in, like, classic, like, wine mom.
Chalk, wine mom.
That handwriting font.
pillows at TJ Maxx.
Yeah.
So,
well, he actually also reveals himself to be a Maxinista later in the book.
Well, right. He does. And I think he comes from a very Maxinista place. And I think that was probably the point of this book, is to like tell America that like he is a Maxinista and not this like East Coast gay who's so snobby.
And you can tell that the book is going to be an absolute meaningless fluff because the blurbs in the back are just like all of the most like HRC, no hate campaign people who are just praising it for being like an awe-inspiring story of a husband.
The joke that Katie Kirk actually read this?
No, of course like, not. Are you kidding?
No, she did not read this.
Anyway, so Chasten, you know, obviously for those who just need a quick refresher, beat Buttigieg, obviously, failed presidential candidate, first major gay, openly gay presidential candidate. Obviously, we know James Buchanan was gay. There's a lot of talk about Lincoln, et cetera.
A lot of talk about Lincoln.
Yeah.
And Ulysses S. Grant, bye. Famous toxic bye, of course.
Original toxic bye. But Chasten is just this like musical theater nerd who is sadly younger than us.
Which is right. I was like, oh, it's so sad he's younger than us. Which is also so Chasten in the book. He's always like, here I am, just a loser substitute teacher with my $50 H&M blazer. And here's my cool boyfriend who's the mayor of South Bend.
Yeah, mayor of a small city. And, you know, Pete obviously did not win the presidential campaign. He succeeded in, like, kind of fucking over Bernie in the way that he dropped out in this very coordinated effort along with Klobuchar to, like, give all the rest of the delegates to Biden in March, like, after Super Tuesday. But his husband is, like, such an inconsequential character. And it was, like, after the campaign ended, Chasten was like, oh, now I need to release a memoir? I'm 33. I've just,
dated a mayor. He's 31. Like, you just shouldn't be allowed unless you've really lived a life of sex, drugs, and rock and roll.
Has absolutely not lived a life. This is an alternative title for this book, I might say, is Memoirs of a Barista?
Yeah, Memoirs of a Starbucks Barista. You can tell in this book, he, as much as I would say in Pete's book, he thought he was Obama writing.
Mm-hmm.
Chasten thinks he's David Sedaris, like writing the Santaland diaries.
Yeah.
Being like, and I worked these ridiculous part-time jobs, but it's like, he just tells us actually every single part-time job. It's like, yeah, we've all been young and like worked.
No, it's like
jobs.
It's like confessions of a retail gay, and it's just like, okay, so
but
you worked at Toys R Us.
But they're not even like crazy store. Like
then you moved back to Madison and you worked at Caribou Coffee. Then you started working at Starbucks. Then you put in for a transfer to the Chicago Starbucks.
I mean, I feel like the point of him writing this book was to like show that he was this like Midwestern, you know, came up in agriculture, and it's kind of like, okay, yes, yeah, like your parents didn't have much money and sure, and you like showed steer at the local county fairs. And it's like, I don't know, a little too late, babe.
Well,
like, shouldn't have you like come out with this book about your steer life before the candidacy, not just being like, he did it as a way to like be closeted.
He did it as a, you mean the book or being
steer life? Sorry, 4-H.
Yeah, so sorry. Him being in 4-H was, like, closeted, fine. I'm sure that's true, like, growing up in, like, the northern Michigan peninsula. But, like, him writing about this, like, you know, down-home, small-town, real America backstory is very him just kind of, like, copying Pete. And Pete was already completely fake as a political politician. And, like, you know, we've talked about this in the past. And I was very hard on him during the campaign. Thank you. But, like, you know, Pete is very, very fake, doesn't believe in anything. Politics is like purely just like naked ambition for him. It's like a total careerist choice, and he doesn't really have political philosophy, but he kind of like, you know, he mimics like all of these
right,
things.
Pete, I'm just from the Midwest.
I'm a small town guy who's really polite and nice.
I like fishing, and that's not normally considered gay. If I can read a passage here,
yeah,
this is like
please
him
do.
Trying to be like, oh, I was so persecuted for being gay, and you're kind of like, this isn't that crazy. When it came to getting ready for school, like we're supposed to be crying here, I was so absorbed with making sure I looked normal, i.e. straight, that I'd put on an outfit, go to the bathroom, look in the mirror, return to my room, and try another option. It's like...
okay, so you're...
SMH, it's like, yeah, high school, yeah, it's like you put on two outfits. It's like we all did. Like
everyone was self-conscious and insecure in high school.
You put
like,
on two different shirts.
On
yeah, it's like, can you believe? I mean, him putting a George Bush sticker on his massive like minivan, like, yes, that's closeted and sad, I guess. It's also so random. I know, like, we live in a bubble from the East Coast, but I'm just like, so we're the same age and you were like 15 and had no idea that George Bush was bad? I guess that was him being closeted and being, and his like funky friend was like, why do you have that in your car?
Yeah, but you know, you're surrounded by, no. I mean, listen, like, you know, it's not just bubble, right? Like, you grew up in, like, you grew up in Cambridge, Massachusetts. Like,
Harvard.
The absolute epicenter of just, like, you know.
No, I know.
You know, the start of, like, woke liberalism happened in Cambridge. So it's like, of course you're around people who are just being like, fuck Bush, fuck the war. And it's just like.
No, you're right. So, I take that back.
I mean, I remember, you know, I remember driving in the Volvo with my mother, okay, around the start of the Iraq War. And, you know, even me as a kid, you know, you're reading the funnies, whatever. I'm not fucking glued to the guy. I'm not some political
star. Wait, do you remember in middle school we did, like, a fake vote?
For president?
Yeah, for president. Anyway, and it was, like, we all got to vote. And, like, I remember, like, it actually was kind of half and half. Mm. And I remember being, like, so fucking disturbed, man. I was like, where do you guys fucking live,
man? Where do you guys fucking live?
Dude, okay, there's a war going on.
And you were just, like, 12, living 12? In Cambridge? Just, yeah. Like, just never experienced like, hardship in your life, like going up to another 12-year-old, just being like, and your vote in this student mock election is violence. I mean, you definitely were not confronting anyone.
No, I don't think I was confronting, like, the random repubs.
But I guess I'll say I do remember my mom explaining something to me about the Iraq War at a young age. And I was like, you know, I never heard this before. And I was like, you know, mom, like, is the war a good idea? And she was like, she goes, I think we're going to war for all the wrong reasons. I think it's about
she was
money.
Orgasming.
Your mother has a
dramatic tale.
She was like, I think it's about oil. I think it's about money. I think he wants to go there because Saddam tried to kill his daddy and he wants revenge. Mm. And, you know, that actually really stuck with me because I do think politics is very personal.
Very personal.
It is a very vindictive world. I mean, not everyone necessarily knows that age. So I'm not like, it's not shocking that him as this like closeted 13-year-old was just like, yes, Bush.
Well, and he was also just, like, doing it to look badass. Okay, I will say, like, as much as we will roast Chasten, I did, like, okay, I'm just going to admit, like, up front, I chuckled at some stuff.
I chuckled a few times at, like, his Starbucks, like, anecdotes.
His Starbucks anecdotes and, like, him, like, mentioning his, like, totally bad cars.
I guess, let me just say this, though. I just found it a very transparent attempt to, like, you know, have this sort of neoliberal fantasy of like, I'm a do-gooder person from the do-gooder heart of the country. And my parents were hardscrabble people who cared about community. And it's this absolute complete lie that it's just like, we heartland folk like know how to look out for each other. When it's
and
just
everything
like,
is like, and that's Northern Wisconsin
and
for
I'm just
you.
Like, you are like a fucking little bitch, Chasten. And like you and Pete like invented like Karen culture and you're like such tattletales.
Like,
and it's just like, you are like why we live in this just like downward spiral of just like Karen-ing everyone and just like everyone's fucking bitch. And it's like, you don't represent a society that like looks out for each other and like doesn't call the cops and actually like goes and talks to your neighbor first. And so just like, I just found that to be inauthentic.
Well, he never actually like says what his politics are.
He never says anything about what his politics are.
It's like, so babe, you're going to go on and on about just like the way you applied to this teacher job and like the third admission process. And then when they called you back and then like you parked in this parking spot.
But then I'm like, see, but then that comes
back.
But
that's the point.
But
he's
that's
not,
the point, and he actually
there's nothing
just,
behind
he
it.
He is a wife, and I'm kind of just like, maybe just, like, go off with your wife self. And it's kind of like, no, I don't need the wife to be so fake and like, pretending that she knows everything about politics, because he's, like, going to Europe for the campaign and being like, okay, and then they were asking me about Brexit, and I was literally, like, panicking because I didn't know anything about Brexit. And I'm like, okay, that's actually kind of honest.
No, and I think he's also very honest about, like, always kind of being insecure about Pete, like, being, like, a Rhodes Scholar, and he's, like, hot, and then, like, I would, like, make fun of him because, like, I actually have a master's degree. I guess, like, I really wanted to know, I'm like, can we talk about your first night together making love?
Oh, he certainly is not going to talk about that.
So he talked about their first date, which, like, actually sounded pretty rom-com.
So rom-com.
It's like he rents a car from O'Hare, drives to Indiana. They met on Hinge, and their whole thing is that they met on Hinge, but he was chatting him in O'Hare.
Yeah.
And so, that became their place during the campaign when they were always ships in the night. Like
they would stop by gate D5 where Chasten was sitting texting him on Hinge for the first time.
It's like, that's their place.
It's really kind of dark as sort of like a symbol of like what fucking modern romance is. Just
like, and he's always like, yes, I met Mayor Pete Buttigieg on Hinge. Also, it's like kind of this gross way of how he calls him like Peter.
Oh, barf.
Throughout the book.
Yeah.
And if we haven't mentioned, or if you haven't guessed it, Chasten is a huge bottom.
Oh, I was just going to say, like, do we need to state the obvious?
Yeah, like, Pete pounds him again. I guess every man we read has a medium dick. I feel like that just in every episode, we're just like, and...
The dick is
But I feel like
medium,
Pete's
ladies.
Is, like, thin, right? It's thin, but medium.
There's all these points where he, like, really kind of, like, psychosexualizes the, like, you know, the top-bottom dynamic in their relationship in this way where he's obviously so turned on, where he's just like, yeah, I got home and I changed the wall collar and Pete didn't even notice.
And he's like, if you'll notice in some of those, like, random documentaries, and it's like, no, I don't remember.
No, I don't remember this, like, Good Morning America, like, five-minute segment from 2018.
And he's, I mean, the whole time he's being so meme straight guys, like, how do you live with like this? Like, yeah, bed on floor?
No, he's pretending that Pete's so mattress on floor, and it's like, babe, not even. Please.
Yeah, it's like, it's just, when he moves in with Pete, that's where the book... So basically, first half of the book is him. The way he organizes this book is cuckoo. Like,
well, I feel like it's just kind of chronological.
No, I feel like it's not chronological. That's what's crazy. Like, he goes on for chapters and chapters about transferring to different University of Wisconsin's.
No, I know.
And then we go back in time in the next chapter to talk about each part-time job in each area of Wisconsin.
That's true, but I
and
guess...
I'm like, we could have condensed this.
Well, but that's kind of like, I feel like that's his section of his just like gay. And again, there's this gay panic of just like transferring to a million different U Wisconsin campuses and be like, and then I went back to Eau Claire and then I was in debt again. And then I moved back with my parents, and then I went to Madison. Now, I know what you're thinking. Madison, not exactly New York City, but here's the thing. I was scared. And it's like, no, we get it. You're a terrified bottom who's afraid of his own shadow.
Okay. When he finally gets to, like, University of Wisconsin, Eau Claire, this is also kind of crazy, because my girlfriend went to University of Wisconsin.
Wow.
But not...
Sorry, that's actually spooky.
But not any of the ones that he went to. She went to Madison.
State school vibes.
And he went to Milwaukee and Eau Claire.
Wow, so they never overlapped.
They really were just kind of...
I wonder if they would have been friends.
He works at this gay bar called Sidetracks in Eau Claire that, like, did sound so fun.
No,
and he wears... And he's like... And they told me the uniform and was in V-neck, and you know that was, like, prime American Apparel time, and he was in, like,
the
deepest purple V.
In his absolute, like... alabaster, just like looking like a goddamn thumb, just like the pinkest little
oh, he does
twink.
Look like a thumb.
Yeah.
And it sounded like he only really lasted for 6 months. And he was like, and I asked this drag queen how to make a Cosmo. And she was like, honey, this is the only time that I'm going to tell you how to make a Cosmo.
And he was like, and I never forgot. No, and it's so, and you see it coming. He's kind of admitting to the reader. He's like, but, you know, I kind of couldn't really deal with the sort of the flirting and the late nights and the shots and the drinking. It's like, oh, no, honey, you couldn't.
Yeah, like.
Wasn't your scene.
Chasten and Pete define the type of couple that goes to bar trivia. And this is someone who has hosted a bar trivia night.
Well, you hosted, like, lesbian bar trivia in New York.
Yeah, New York City. So it's actually totally different. I'm talking about mixed trivia where it's, like, sports, geography, Harry Potter.
Yeah. It's not specific to any sort of, like, queer canon. It's literally just Harry Potter and Star Wars.
Oh, and we haven't even talked about how the book starts.
At a Thai restaurant. That's actually how... That's, like, defines B-list.
Yeah, Thai food.
And then there's later in the book where Ty comes up again and he's just like, and there I was working at Starbucks, dating yet another nurse practitioner and going to a night at Thai food. And I was too embarrassed to bring them home to my, like, shared sub-level basement apartment. And I'm just like, God, I'm embarrassed just reading this.
And then one time, this is towards the end of the book, he wants to, like, respond to some sassy homophobe on Twitter. And he's like, I wish I would have posted a GIF of Kate from The Office, but I didn't.
Well, he keeps kind of referring to, I think, the justification for writing this book as the fact that he, like, was able to grow this, like, incredible social media presence over the course of a campaign. And just, like, I was the one they looked to for reaction GIFs. I was the one they looked to for Hamilton references. And it's kind of just, like, sure, but it's just, like, this isn't exactly, like, a skill. This is just literally you being, like, every other person on Twitter. Sorry, you don't have a unique voice.
Right, I think there's a moment in the book where he's, like, and then something happened that I never expected. And then it's just that he, like, got a Twitter following.
So as we're talking about sort of writing and technique and, like, why this book is good or not, I do want to read what I think is one of the funniest passages in the book, which is the part about his time at Starbucks and the bitchy customers. There was a woman I'll call Cassie, whose loud car would roll up to the drive-thru multiple times a day. "Hi, it's Cassie," her script began. We knew her order by heart. Triple Venti Zebra Mocha with extra mocha drizzle, and extra whipped cream. Around Christmas, Starbucks offers mocha shavings. They're festive. So during the holidays, she'd request those as well. In practical terms, this drink involved a good inch or two of mocha sauce and a mere 5 or 6 ounces of milk and espresso, and the remainder consisted of whipped cream and drizzle. Nevertheless, it was not uncommon for her to swing back around a couple minutes later and say into the loudspeaker, "Hey, there's not enough mocha."
I want to meet Cassie so bad. No, this was actually funny. And it's like, okay, like, you know, I was like, yes, Chasten is so B-list. But like, if I was, say, in a math class with him over a study abroad program.
Yeah. Oh, you would have been best friends.
We would have been absolute chicas.
Yeah. No, I mean, you're a hag in many ways.
I am a hag. Well, did you see this comedian I saw did post that they went to UCB with him in Chicago?
I did see that comedian in question.
Yeah.
We could say Meg Stalter. She was open about it on Twitter. Right, we don't
I don't
need to
know
lie.
Why I'm being like secretive.
No,
about
and
it.
I this like that part like endeared me. You know, he endeared himself to me much more than Pete, because I'm just kind of just like, okay, like you do get it, and like you actually like you've worked on service, you get that just like girls can be insane, and like that is funny, and like that's an important lesson to learn. And, like, Pete has literally just like went to Afghanistan, like chose to go to Afghanistan to be
later
like,
in life,
like later in life, like not because he needed the money, because he just like literally wanted the resume builder. And it's
and like liked freedom for America.
Psycho. Absolute psychopath.
To add on to that psychopath, turns out Pete drives a Jeep Patriot.
Oh, yeah.
How much that is a top gay car, because it's kind of this squished Jeep.
Yeah, it's so squished.
It's not a Cherokee. Not a Wrangler. It's not that insane Jeep that I had a one-day rental.
There's no...
That was the full pickup.
Are you renting
this
a pickup?
Summer?
I bet you feel real cool on
I did. I rented a car, and I asked for the cheapest option.
And you're driving over to Home Depot, and you're getting like a $15 plant and put in the back, and it's rolling around.
I was actually visiting my mother, thank you very much.
What on earth were you putting in the bed? Why did you need the bed?
Here's the thing. I rented the cheap economy car, but there's been such a rush, pandemic stuff.
Oh, sure. Yeah.
So
everyone's getting
cast. The only car left was this massive, massive.
Oh, and they were like, "Excuse me, sir, do you want this super butch car?" And you were like, "Oh, me?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, I guess I do."
And then, of course, I was so awkward, like in the garage at JFK, and I was being so like, beep, 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 and making 80 point turns.
So was the scene in Austin Powers.
Yeah. Yeah, baby.
Yeah, baby. Trucks, baby.
We did it, Pete.
We did it, yeah. But I do think that, no, there's no way that a man driving a Jeep Patriot or Jeep Liberty is over 5'9".
Yeah, it's bubbly, because I was...
It's a little bubble.
It's always a shock to me. I mean, talk about prices in these countries that... Chasten was like, these countries. Chasten was like, oh, my hourly for being like a nurse's assistant was just like $9 an hour. And that's just fucked up, man.
Yeah. Well, you know, what's interesting about minimum wage is that it does vary across the country.
Yes. No. So with, you know.
Lower cost of living states.
Milwaukee, you're getting rent for $900 a month, maybe. So you're getting paid.
But it is shocking. And I do support a national minimum wage of 20.
Well, and also.
And rent control.
It's classic also that Chasten is such a little bitch and it's just like has no idea what Pete even is for.
No,
and it's just
he has
like,
no idea what Pete's position
is. And he's like,
yeah,
we beat Bernie. And it's just like, maybe if you believed in Bernie, you could have gotten fucking paid more as a nurse.
Another interesting part of the book is that this book is basically about a barista with student debt. And then like, and then also medical debt, because he has this like medical episode where he goes,
stomachache?
I had a stomachache and then I lost a lot of blood. I won't do it anymore. And I'm a little like, ooh, I'd like to know, but actually I don't. I was like, thank you. Just like
for the privacy.
For the privacy, let's keep it moving. But he talks so much about medical debt and how crushing it is in this country. And he's like being so politician later in the book because he's just kind of trying to fill pages and just like whatever, like copy pasting Pete Stump's speech. And I'm just kind of like, and yet y'all were like not supporting Medicare for all during the campaign. So
absolutely
what's
not.
The disconnect, sis? And then he'll just be like, but I don't speak for Pete and I don't know his policies.
And he's like, and Pete, all basically he says is like, the same guy you see on stage is the same guy that comes home to me. And I'm like, sad.
Yeah.
That same boring ass man rolling up his sleeves is who's like, hey, Chasten, do you want to watch the latest episode of Game of... Are you like hard right now thinking of that? The latest episode of Game of Thrones. I got us Chipotle bowls for dinner.
Listen, I mean...
You're a bit chickeny.
That is looking at Chasten and going, God damn it.
You got it all.
You got it. You really did it. You know, you bounced around. You went on Hinge. There was a point in my life if I was single and I was, you know, maybe not as like, you know, cravenly ambitious and fame seeking, like I would have met a mayor and said, yes, done. Sign me up. Wife me the fuck up, you know, and I would have been just so I'm envious to some extent of how much he is willing to just sort of like sublimate his life to Pete and how like he takes pride in that. And he'll just be like, yep. And I'm there to just be the support.
There is actually a moment I found kind of cute between Pete and Chasten. Now I'm just their full hag, where Pete discovers Chasten's medical bills and student loans. And he comes up to Chasten. He's like, what are these? And Chasten starts sobbing and thinks he's going to dump him, which family trigger warning. I won't really go into that, but that kind of brings me back.
Because you went through a financial crisis and you thought that, well, I don't think you thought your girlfriend was going to dump you.
No, I'm just more, I would say, me.
Overwhelmed at bills.
Overwhelmed, yeah. You know, overwhelmed bills. And actually, I feel like maybe, yeah, Maya was actually the Pete, like, and being so like, what is this random dental bill? And I'm just being so like, I can't handle it, like root canal. And it's like, yeah, you can actually like pay it off. They are the couple that's like, you know, in like ads for like TD Bank and like where a couple is at a big kitchen table piled with papers with their heads down. And they're like, how are we going to do this? Yeah. And it's like, WAMU.
Yeah.
Mutual funds.
Which also just like define Pete's entire like political perspective. It's just like he just sees himself as in a political ad, just like not actually as having like any really coherent.
And he could
philosophy.
Like, and he saw like McKinsey and just like did make Chasten a spreadsheet, but he's still not just being like Medicare for all. Like you shouldn't have this medical debt. I feel like Pete is still just like, well, you went to the hospital and that's your medical debt and that's your responsibility. But we'll get through it.
We'll get through it together, and I'll make a spreadsheet.
And what was super toppy again of Pete is when like Chasten stops eating on the campaign because they only give him Clif Bars. Mm. And he's like, ew, Clif Bars are disgusting, which they are.
I will say, though, sometimes I'm rushing in the morning. I'm dashing to the office for a high-powered ad executive meeting. And I grab a Clif Bar, and it gives you the fucking calories to power you through the next 6 hours.
I say they're disgusting because I've, like, OD'd on Clif Bars from, like, maid life. Because it is always, like, I grab a sandwich, but then it's 4 p.m., and I become, like, deathly starving, and I still have two bathrooms to clean.
I kind of like Clif Bars. The peanut butter flavor is, like, good.
You eat them. But they are, same amount of calories as a Kit Kat is what Pete was saying. I mean, Chasten.
And then that comes back to the whole calories in, calories out.
Yeah.
Does any kind of calorie matter as long as it's a calorie?
So he's like, he stops eating the Clif Bars, and then he's like, the staff have an intervention with him, which is insane. And then...
I think he was dramatizing that a little bit.
Right. And then because they needed the drama at the end of this election cycle. So then Pete, in front of all of his staffers, tells Chasten, he's like, hey, Chasten, if the staff gives you nuts, eat the fucking nuts. And it's like, damn.
Respect the staffers.
Yeah, eat the fucking nuts.
But,
Chasten, he, like, considered that he was thinking he was going to become Michelle.
Yeah.
And he was like, public education. Movement for the kids.
You know, and have the most vague-ass First Lady initiative.
And I think
sorry, back it up, First Ladies are always teachers.
Well, yeah, it's like the classic. Most like...
Laura Bush.
Because nurses, Jill. Your hours are actually too crazy. And a teacher, you can be like, take off time, where I feel like nurses are like heroes for life.
Yeah. No, they're working. Yeah, teachers are fucking slackers.
Sorry, absolutely respect to all of the teacher folks out there. I want to talk a little bit about their wedding. And again, like...
their wedding, which had official colors.
Purple and purple?
It was purple and blue.
And again, this is them going to the mall in Chasten being like, I thought I was going to have this like Sex in the City, like montage of me trying on suits and like drinking champagne and all these girls.
I didn't really relate it to that. I was like, well, that's literally the reason you want to get married. It's the only reason you want to say yes to the dress montage. Yeah. And he was like, and so we just like walked into like, what was it?
They
got a Ted Baker.
Yeah. But it was like, I feel like at a Nordstrom. Like, it wasn't even like they went to the Ted Baker store.
Can you just back up and pronounce that department store again?
Sorry, Nordstrom. 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 How do you pronounce it? Nordstrom. I guess I really kind of went in there with it.
It's Nordstrom's.
Oh, Nordstrom's.
No, but back to the wedding.
Anyway, so... and again, super top. They went to Nordstrom and they were like, we want like purple and blue suits. And then like a guy just gave them two suits. They tried them on, then they fit. And then he was like,
but he was like, it was a dark blue suit with undertones of purple.
Undertones.
Which I can totally, I actually remember this New York Times Vows article with them. And it like, that actually does accurately describe it. And like, I can't think of anything more just like 5'8 gay than just like two undertoned purple suits.
Well, I've also been watching a lot of Say Yes to the Dress lately, and I feel like the gay host of that does wear a lot of suits that are kind of purple undertoned.
You got marriage on the brain, darling?
I don't know. It's a little bit of fun, you know, see the options.
Ooh. Wait. Dream wedding. Go.
Vegas?
Wow.
I don't know. No.
Okay, I'll go first. Vatican.
Okay. Oh, wait, St. Patrick's Cathedral. Hello.
Oh, you want to be in St. Patrick's?
Yes.
Like, historically, like, LGBTQ, yeah. Like, bi, like,
I
anti-gay
have
cathedral.
I want to have the first gay wedding at St. Patrick's
And you
cathedral.
Want, like, a 21, like, gun salute from all these, like, homophobic firefighters.
I want all, never forget, I want just, like, all of FDNY there.
Yeah, no, that sounds... you just want a big... you want bagpipes.
I basically want bagpipes.
I mean, that's
pipes.
Very Charlotte's second wedding to Harry. Her first wedding to Trey. You just really want bagpipes. I have to say, I hate it when gays get married in kilts. It's just, at this point...
No.
Do you know what I mean?
I thought of that because
I'm just
like,
kind of like, what's your connection, babe? The connection is, you're gay. I'm just like, you want to be a skirt?
You're fetishizing.
You love Madonna. I'm just a little bit just like, it's like, if you've never worn a kilt before, I just find it a little bit like,
no, it's true. Because I used to think I wanted to get married in a kilt, but it's like actually only iconic if you're literally Scottish.
Yeah.
And you're not just being like, how wacky am I?
No, I hate it.
I think I want to get married in.
Well, you know, to actually, to quote Jacqueline Novak on her.
Oh, yeah, no, let's quote
when
the
she
genius.
Talks,
yeah.
She talks on her podcast, Poog, about getting married in Converse. And she was like, heels are never more present than when a bride wears Converse. And I feel like that the analogy is kilts on a man. Whereas, yeah. Like, the suit, the tux is never more present.
Because you've made
than
this
when a man's in a
alt
kilt.
Decision.
You made this alt decision to show off your hairy legs and be like, get it? I'm a man.
And also, I feel like most men probably who do wear the kilts, they're in like the craziest, like tightest mid-calf leather boots.
No, I know.
I guess my dream wedding outfit is just classic Sabrina, the old film, kind of white dinner jacket,
of course.
Black tuxedo pants.
Oh, wait, you want white jacket with black pants? I was picturing you for this. I was going like, oh, she wants white suit, cigar.
No, it's that cigar. Because white suit is almost like, that gets too bindle and keep and
well,
clear.
No, and I was like, someone's going to have to stop you from getting a pimp cane. Because you know your wedding is going to be like so queer anyway. And there's going to be a lot of like disabled folks with canes. And it's going to be such a... a cane check, and it's like, we don't need the pimp cane. Can you reel it in for a minute?
The bagpipe check, cane check. Police baton check.
Police baton check. Policeman with chronic pain.
Okay, just back to Chasten. The best part about planning your wedding was that Peter didn't care about the little details, cackles evilly. He came to our initial get-to-know-you meeting with the wedding planner and was so out of his element that he helped pick the colors blue and purple and then gracefully bowed out. And then, of course, they get a taco truck for the wedding.
They have, like, the most just, like, absolutely like peat South Bend IPA
mason jar
where it was like it was so like it was like so like desperately political. It was like such a desperate
clearly
campaign
they
ad.
invited 500 people.
They invited 500 people. It was the entire town of South Bend. Everything was like a local South Bend maker, a local South Bend brewer, a local South Bend taqueria, like everything was a fucking like reclaimed former factory turned into a ski ball arcade.
Oh yeah, he's like, me and Pete's favorite like arcade games were ski ball. I mean,
and
ski
it's like, you know,
fun.
And this
and
is
again,
like,
I guess I wish I was
Pete's
invited.
Sort of only economic initiative is like bulldoze like black families' houses and just like reclaim factories and like build beer halls, and like everything is just this like incredibly boring like gingham button down like 5'8" gay playground where everyone goes to bed at 10.
Speaking of Pete bulldozing black communities, I think Chasten kind of really just passes over a little Pete controversy where he
the glossing is insane.
Glossy.
He doesn't mention a single one of my scathing viral tweets against Pete. He just says like, yeah, and there's one where he's like, yeah, like leftist Twitter was against him. And like Pete knows about leftist ideology because he studies. But then he like doesn't actually get into any of the specifics, like doesn't talk anything, like doesn't really like, you know, respond to any of the criticisms, just as like, now, the internet can be a weird place where people say dramatic things, shall we say. And it's like, thank you for sort of describing it as most broad.
Well, he loves also to talk about like his amazing judgment on like when to talk back and when not to talk back. Mm. He's like, if I could tell a person was like totally crazy at the grocery store, like I wouldn't talk back. But sometimes like I would have like an amazing comeback, and that's where his UCB skills come in play.
Oh, and his retorts were always just like someone just being like, hey, can you ask your husband to like fix the road? And he'd just be like, huh, I'll get in touch with his staff. And it's just like, that's not really a retort.
Right.
I will say one part where I did think that he had a point to make, and I was just saying this to you earlier, like I when he like at the end when he some friend accuses him of becoming less funny on social media.
Uh-huh.
It's true.
Has that happened to you?
I think it's happened to all of us.
Mm-hmm.
We
yeah.
look back at our tweets from 7 years ago. We look back at our Facebook posts, our Instagram posts from 5 years ago, and they were so much freer and sillier. And now it's like, I just feel like every post has to be like
no
so
promo.
Approved by committee.
And
it's like such
like,
promo.
I feel like I would gram like, you know, like a ridiculous sandwich. And obviously I still do that. You know what I mean?
Yeah, you definitely gram sandwiches.
I mean, and just like, I don't know. Or it's more, I feel like it would be more like your face. That's like 19 person Facebook album
yeah.
of like yeah. us at a weird like bath sauna opening.
Yeah.
Open drinks.
Us at an open drinks. I saw this photo right up. I was looking at Facebook for some reason. And I saw like one of the times that I had been brutally assaulted in Bushwick. And I had this like black eye and I was like looking insane. And I, like, uploaded a photo of myself because of my boyfriend at the time, just being like, has Rihanna taught us nothing? And it's just, like, actually yeah. cancel boots
yeah.
for saying something like that. But
cancel teeny.
Back in the day, we could just make those sort of jokes about domestic violence. And it's like, you know, I do miss those times.
Celebrity Book Club.
Segment boots.
How does he live?
What does she wear? What does she eat?
What does she eat?
Okay, so let's start with what does she eat?
Chipotle. Graham rolls.
He's the most like Chicago gay. So
yeah.
it's literally just Chipotle and like
hearty salad.
Office lunch food. They don't care about food. They're not foodies at all. They like, they might go to a new restaurant because
Thai. It's Thai.
Yeah, they like
well, that's
Thai.
That's what I'm saying. They,
it's
not
culture.
That they're not.
But they don't like cook fab meals. He's not into Allison Roman. Like,
may I disagree for a moment?
Please do.
I think he made the shallot pasta.
I really don't think he did, babe.
There's a moment where he's stirring a spaghetti sauce. I just feel like he was reading the times and he had more time in his hands and he was like, I'm gonna do it. And he spent like the whole
yes.
day making
agreed.
That's what I'm saying, like
he,
one
he
Roman.
Tried one recipe once and like spent the whole day doing it and they were like, this is nice, and then they ordered takeout again the next night. But he doesn't derive pleasure from either making food or like being interested in like different flavors unless it's like, you know, the restaurant was just like recently opened by a veteran, like in town.
In the Chicago way, I think he also just like loves deep dish. You know what I mean? Like,
Yeah,
he's
well,
cheese,
there is,
yeah.
I mean, there is a point in the book where he's accused of having gained weight.
Oh, and he also references how he doesn't fit into the Banana Republic suit anymore. And it's like, even though, and what's probably happening is like, he's not eating the nuts and the Clif Bars. And at 11 p.m., he's like,
he's binging,
wolfing
yeah.
a Chipotle bowl. Because when I haven't eaten and then I have Chipotle.
Oh, wow.
It's like you get so full so fast and you're wolf. You don't even know. You know, it's like you're at the first two bites are good and then no. it just becomes like a slop.
It's a shock to the body.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I just think I'm not saying like I think he does. He appreciates food in this like daddy makes a good bass after we go fishing.
But here's what I'm saying. I don't think that he could like taste three basses and like appreciate the difference between the three basses. I think they may eat a bunch of different food sometimes for on whatever occasion it is. But I don't think he has like a palate to be like, oh, this like this restaurant's pasta was really good. This restaurant's pasta was like a little overcooked. Like this like banh mi like had a, was like too like, you know, too sweet or whatever. I don't think that
well,
he
yeah,
has
maybe
that
maybe he's
palate.
Not like you and like the hugest little bitch.
But I'm just saying he's
earth.
Not, they're
yeah.
not foodies. Like, I
yeah,
don't think
no,
that that's
but,
their culture.
But
at
like,
all.
But he may, he's not foodies, but I think he loves food, is what I'm saying. Like, you, he's.
Well, you're just saying he's like a little bit of an eater.
Yeah.
Do you think they're going to one of our favorite restaurants in Chicago, Halsted Bar and Grill?
That's what I'm
and
saying.
And getting a like, massive goat cheese salad
yes.
where it's like, it's a salad, but it's 1,200 calories.
Right, where it's just like huge pieces of goat cheese,
yeah.
huge pieces of cranberries,
yes.
huge breaded chickens. And he's like, oh my God, like I'm so excited to show you my favorite restaurant.
Yeah.
And it's a gay bar and grill.
And then they're getting the popcorn chicken.
Yeah, because I think Pete is probably... To reference one of our other books, he's a little chicken on the side, no sauce.
Well, he's like pretending to be busy, so yeah.
Right,
he's like
and he's like not
much.
Eating. So what does he wear? I mean, just like H&M. He literally says like he hasn't gone shopping in like years.
Everything is purple. Purple button down. Purple gingham. Purple deep V-neck.
But now I think it's, right, it's this like ill, it's this J. Crew super thin or H&M super thin
yeah.
sweater over colored shirt.
No, I
and,
mean,
like,
J. Crew and Banana Republic Gap are all owned by the same company famously, and I think that he patronizes all three quite frequently, shall we say. He is just a boring, preppy 5'8 DC gay. I mean, DC style is
the worst style.
Is the worst style in the country.
It's the biggest insult you can give to anyone.
But certainly not like he has like, you know, I mean, I guess Midwestern style is kind of like that. Midwestern gay style is kind of DC
style. I mean, he
style.
Defines heathered soft, heathered yeah. tea. And there's a moment in the book where he talks about like all these people coming up to him in shirts that say team husband.
Oh.
Which.
I mean, I have a tattoo that says husband, but that's like ironic or whatever. But yes, I agree. Horrifying. I was going to say his tattoos.
Oh, the Jiffy.
He has the Jif logo without the Jif text.
Oh.
Which is the most psycho, like corporate gay, like culture by committee, like decision where you're just like, I love this Jif brand peanut butter because this anecdote about how his dad always said, if you can afford Jif, you're doing okay.
Good.
It was like this, like, whatever, like lower middle class, like badge of honor to have like a Jif on the cabinet. And so he like has it as this like small town, like hero thing, but he literally didn't want to have, it's like, this is what would happen if you, like, consulted a team and they were like, well, in case, like, Jif gets canceled in the future, we don't want to have the word Jif on your body. So you can have the Jif colors and logo without the actual word Jif. And it's like, that is the most psychotic thing I've ever heard.
I missed that. I thought he had, like, a big-ass block lettering Jiffy tat. But it's...
Yeah.
Just says, like... Jiffy and like little Times New Roman.
Okay, so you're confused. So there's Jif and there's Skippy.
Oh, right. It's Jif.
Jiffy not, is Jiffy Lube. It's a different
yeah.
brand. You're thinking
cars.
I get
thinking
it,
cars.
Right?
I'm a gearhead.
You're
a gearhead. Okay.
You're always thinking cars.
Oil pedal to the
metal. This, that, and the other, you know, stick shift.
Engines, gas, fuel, hybrids.
Yeah, he has the Jif logo without the word Jif, which is just such a clear-cut metaphor, which is the absolute emptiness of their political point of view.
Okay, how does he live? I mean, he's clearly slowly renovating. I mean, that whole part of the book just turned into a House Hunters episode.
You know what I'm going to say. High bed.
Oh, yeah. I mean, you're
they define... High bed. They define beagle shavings on every massive overstuffed brown leather or microfiber couch in the house.
I just think, like, they have like a disgust. Well, he says it's disgusting floral futon that he's like, and you know, I wanted to get rid of it.
And I'm
but
like,
we didn't have a couch budget. And it's like, even if you did have a couch budget, you would have gotten a disgusting new Raymour and Flanagan
microfiber couch. And it's like, the fact that you even had the floral futon, it's just like, if that was ever an option in your mind, like, that means that you have horrible taste and you have the highest bed ever. There's like six plastic bins stored underneath. There's dog hair on every surface
it's
of the house.
It's also the hugest dog beds you could ever imagine. And it's very, I feel like, our friend Daniel's parents' bedroom. No. Huge cages in bedroom.
It's so suburban. It's so snack drawer. It's just like, literally, like, this is where my fucking libido goes to die. Like, I walk in this house and I'm like, I am no longer hard.
Like, yes, he's topping him and he's telling him to eat the fucking nuts, but, like, the beagle got to clean that house. And I don't like a lot of dogs, but I do like beagles because my gay uncle
had a beagle. Beagles.
Well, my giggle with the a beagle.
Are beagle a fixture beagle like the long eared ones?
That's basset hounds, but I also like them. I like a short, stout dog. Beagles, like,
are you thinking dachshunds?
No.
What is a beagle?
A beagle is like what Daniel's parents said.
Oh, they're kind of cute. They're like kind of cute in a dachshund way or whatever. But I'm
they're
just
like
kind
hunting
of like
dogs. They're
whatever.
Fatter.
They're dogs. You know, I hate dogs.
Yeah,
they're
we're both
insecure.
Like,
they're absolutely desperate and disgusting. Get away from me.
But if you're going to have a dog, I don't mind a beagle, but I'm sure the hair is...
Oh, it's a nightmare.
Everywhere.
I feel so bad for the maid that must clean their home. Oh, things that I'm sure... It's like... Well,
I'm sure they have a maid.
I'm sure they have a maid.
She comes once a month and is like, there's so much.
And it's so much. And she's only getting paid $400 to clean this entire old house that has like so much dust in the baseboards.
I think they're like $225-ing her. Wow. I think it's a $225. And they're like...
That's so true because it's South Bend.
And it's South Bend. And
that's like literally the max a maid is even making in South Bend.
And they're like, can you do 4 hours? They want her out in 4 hours.
I'm sure she's doing a good ass clean.
She's doing an amazing
job. Good bitch clean.
And I'm sure, you know, Chasten, as a good wife should, like, is cleaning up for the maid.
He's doing a pre-made tidy, absolutely.
Which you need to do the actual clean.
But the thing is, the clean that she's doing, it's like, those baseboards, those cushions, those fabrics covered in all that fucking hair and all that fucking dust. And it's an old house. Like, you couldn't pay me $1,000 to clean that fucking
house. Let's start a GoFundMe for Chasten and Pete's maid.
Yeah. Their nameless maid who does not go thanked in the acknowledgments. Okay. I mean, have we dragged this faggot enough?
Yeah, I guess we're never going to a high top with him. Sad, but... I think we made our high bed
we'll have to live in it.
Literally
haven't done Who Are You in the Book.
Oh my God, Who Are You in the Book? So, first off, I'm the German French
who's super dry
and like
Franzi.
Franzi, who like connect, like makes plans for him on weekends and like, but also tells him that he's gay you're Chasten.
You're the sturdy German.
Sturdy German who's like, you should come with us to the club this weekend.
Oh, am I Chasten? He sucks.
Well, I'm saying you're Chasten in that moment in relation to me being the sturdy German. I'm not saying you're 100% Chasten.
But
I'm just saying.
Aren't I more Pete because I'm like so pretentious and I'm like so obnoxious and like being so politics?
You're just not Pete though because you're just
He's
not
so weird.
Sleeves rolled up.
No. I'm waking up at one. Like, Pete is not waking up at one.
No, like, yes, you're politics, but like.
Yeah.
Yeah, sorry. So, I mean, the other option is I saw that, like, maybe you're the boyfriend that, like, took him by the collar and was like, shut up.
Oh, my God. I'm not that violent. I've never been violent.
No, you've never been violent.
In a non-consensual way.
I just think you would have been annoyed dating Chasten.
But am I, at that one political dinner, am I the consultant who comes up to Chasten and tells him he needs to lose weight?
Oh, yeah. That... Ever thought about losing weight? Right, I think you're part that. But I think you're a little more Chasten in the youth, you know. Not Chasten now.
I mean,
but
I literally was a Boy Scout. That makes a lot of sense.
Yeah, you're a Boy Scout. You're travel.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Clock me.
Yep.
From here to Berlin, sweetheart.
Okay, so, well, we're going to go board an Amtrak.
Listen, to me, this is a skip.
I have nothing. Yeah, he doesn't have really anything to tell you.
Yeah, it's not. I mean, It's funny if you kind of want like a...
If you come upon it and maybe open it up and read it with your friends a little bit, read the Starbucks chapter.
It's not a page turner though. Like it's, you're just kind of like, thanks, babe. You know, you're speed reading half of it. Like
I was page turning once we got to the wedding a little bit.
The wedding was good. The Starbucks section was fine, but it was like a lot of it was just like, next.
Really?
Bitch.
Yeah. Next. So this is a skip unless you find it for free on the street.
Yeah.
And like bring it home and then put it back on the street.
Yeah. I mean, you know, if you are a gay person who works in politics, like maybe you would
who
find,
grew up doing 4-H and like, are from Northern Michigan,
there might be content that you that's super relevant to you. But even then, I'm just kind of like, this doesn't really go there for me.
Yeah. One meatball.
I give it to Heather Gravy next.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, I guess it's like I give it 1.5 IPAs, triple hazy IPAs. I give it 1 dog walk.
Shall we promo the next book?
Yeah. So next week, we're going to be reading David Chang's book, CEO of Momofuku.
I'm super excited.
I'm wicked excited.
I fucking love Momofuku.
Yum, yum, yum.
Good
yum.
Ass food. Talk about foodies. There's a foodie for
there's it. A guy
yeah.
who loves food. So we're going to be reading that. So like, follow, subscribe.
Like, follow, subscribe. Follow us at CBC The Pod, etc.
Bye.
See you at Starbucks. Best.
Ciao.
Okay, sorry, I'm super stressed. Today's been a very long day, but I just had my second shot of cold brew, so here we go. It's the credits. Celebrity Book Club is presented by Prologue Projects and HeadGum, and everyone there is so nice, and I really, really am so grateful to them for all their work. The show is produced by Meg Renade, who I'm obsessed with editorial support from Andrew Parsons and Leon Nafok. Engineering by Ferris Monchi, who actually helped me through a really, really tough time. Original theme song by Stephen Phillips Horst. Artwork by Teddy Blanks at Chips NY, who's really, really nice if you get to know him. Follow us on Twitter at CBCThePod. Subscribe on your favorite podcast app. And leave us a review. And honestly, it really helps because some people can be super, super mean on the information superhighway. So we'd appreciate if you could go out there in the interwebs and, I don't know, be nice for a change. And don't forget to tell all your friends about us. Okay, I'll see you on the internet. Bye.
That was a HeadGum Podcast.